Until the ninth week of fetal development, the external genitalia of females and males is identical. The central element is a vertical opening known as the urogenital sinus. This is flanked on either side by the urogenital folds. Outside of these lesser folds, there is a larger pair of labioscrotal folds. At the top of the urogenital opening, there's a fleshy projection known as the genital tubercle. In the third month, male and female genitalia began to differ significantly. In the female fetus, development proceeds along the lines of the original structures. The genital tubercle elongates and swells to form the clitoris. The urogenital sinus becomes progressively less deep, forming a shallow vestibule. Meanwhile, the urethral and vaginal orifices are brought to the surface and open into this vestibule. On either side are the urogenital folds, which become the labia minora, and the labioscrotal folds, which enlarge to form the labia majora. The fate of the urogenital and labioscrotal folds is quite different in the male, where they do not remain separate as they do in the female. In the male, the genital tubercle elongates progressively. The urogenital orifice migrates along its underside, and the urogenital folds are pulled along with it. The penis is formed as these folds are pulled together and eventually fuse around the urogenital groove, which now becomes the urethra. The labioscrotal folds also grow towards each other and fuse to form the scrotum. The line of closure will always remain visible down the center of the penis and scrotum. So, in a sense, it is appropriate to say that the male genitalia has been paved over.
And made it all women because they're easier for me to work with, and I knew that it would be easier for other women to work in an all-women's garage, because all the women I knew that were working in other auto repair garages were the only women here. I looked for women that were specifically not anti-male, because I wasn't doing this to to make a politically separatist place. In fact, I really wanted to keep politics out of it. In a field that's 99.9% men, if you start off identifying yourself as a feminist, they're going to dislike you right away. And I think you can get more done for the movement if you just don't identify yourself as doing that specifically. When I first came down here, all of my neighbors are men. There are 12 garages here. I know when I first started, they all waited for weeks for the real boss to show up. I'm sure they thought I was his daughter or his niece or something. But I started walking around and introducing myself to my neighbors. And a couple of them were at first waiting for some sort of brusque anti-male attitude from me, which would have turned them away immediately. And I specifically avoided all of that kind of stuff.
Cada cual con su conciencia, la ley mi propia verdad. Yo no acepto penitencia, penitencia sin pecar. Todos le llaman delito.
Anyway, I got sidetracked. The main point is, don't expect too much in the way of feelings. That's how I am. We can sleep together from time to time, whenever I want to. I'm talking. Of course we'll talk. Interesting talks about things like your poetry, my work, maybe gossip about friends. As a first step toward reducing the massive federal... We can eat out sometimes. You know, where they have candles and soy sauce bottles on the table. We go to late-night films and meet our friends shivering online. Walks, perhaps. Parties. If your behavior's not too primitive. Sex with other people. Well, of course. Look, you're quite free. I don't go in for that middle-class monogamy crap. I mean, isn't that what I've just been saying? Oh, and that reminds me. Independence. I'll tell it to you straight. I'm not into women who don't lead their own lives strongly from their own centers. I want someone who's got no fears of being alone. What do you mean I'm here now and have been for the last few nights? You can explain that one later. Look, I want you to be independent and available. Within reason, of course. You'll have to do other things from time to time. What the fuck do you mean contradictory? I'm perfectly reasonable. You must never, never let anybody dictate your life to you. I mean, I respect your inner life. I respect that you're different from me. I read your poems, don't I? All I want is for you to do the same. Mutual respect. Well, I can't do it for you, can I? I can only be your friend. What do you mean, a millstone? I run a fucking daycare center 2 days a week. I've read more books about feminism than you ever have. I've been into women's problems for years. Are you drunk? Well, stop laughing then. What was that? I make up all the rules? You're fucking jealous, that's your trouble. Hysterical, insecure, colonizing, possessive?
There was an exchange of fire today between Israeli gunboats and Islamic militias in northern Lebanon, UPI's Steve Hagee reports.
Israeli gunboats have drawn heavy fire from Islamic fighters in the northern Lebanese port of Tripoli.
That would be stupid. You're not being at all reasonable. Listen, why don't I put the coffee on? Oh, look, there's just one thing I want to ask about. Come on. Are you, well, I mean, is it difficult with me, or do you actually have orgasms with other people? More recently, that is. Well, it's not pleasant for a man to have to ask, is it? Oh, I'll just make the coffee then.
The House gave final approval to the measure early this morning. The legislation will reduce highway construction funds for states which do not raise the minimum.
Lap when I was 15. Sicker than a dog, all I wanted to do was go home. And all he wanted was a blowjob. My God, the naivety of those days. Passed along friends of boyfriends, sandwiched between rednecks in the back of a pickup in broad daylight. Raped by my own friend's boyfriends. But I always thought, this is your fault. You got yourself into this one. And it all came down to survival. There was never much choice about it. They always had the car, or the brute strength, or the numbers. You were always somewhere where you weren't supposed to be, and you certainly couldn't tell your parents. And then it really happened, and I woke up with him on top of me. All these years, I've had visions of men in ski masks jumping out of bushes. It wasn't supposed to happen in my own bed. Asking me if I would be enjoying this if I knew him. I thought I did know him, but I'll never be sure. I saw him in the cafeteria about a week later. He asked, "How's it going?" I said, "Not too good. I was raped last week." His face couldn't decide what to do, but it smiled first. Had I called the police? Did I know who it was? And then he looked up and said, "Wouldn't it be funny if it was someone you knew?" For the next 2 months, every party I went to, that guy tried to pick me up.
Uh-huh. I think it's important for women to know that even though in their case they may feel that their hysterectomy was necessary, between one-third and one-half of the hysterectomies that have been done are not necessary. And those audits have been done by public health researchers working in several different settings, notably working with unions, for example, that saw an increase in the rate of hysterectomies after the institution of group coverage for surgery, for example. So the best insured people are the most likely to get them. It's also true, however, that the Medicaid population, the poor people who've been covered by the federal government, may be at higher risk for hysterectomies if they go to teaching hospitals because, as we know, young students in training must perform a certain number of these procedures in order to be qualified to become specialists. The Center for Disease Control in Atlanta, which is a part of our government, tracks the incidence of hysterectomy and has noted that about half of the hysterectomies done are done on younger women. Therefore, it's amazing to think that if the present trends continue, 62% of women in this country will have had a hysterectomy by the time they're 70. And approximately 50% of women at 50 have already had one. This is a kind of a wholesale removing of organs which shows variations from one country to another. For example, in England and in other European countries, it's very clear that the rates are much, much lower, and that women seem to be doing very well. I think the tradition of gynecology as we know it began with the assumption that if women were not behaving in a proper way, that some part of them perhaps should be removed. Or if they had a disease, then the way to remove the disease was to remove the part that had the disease. For example, 100 years ago, it was very, very common to remove ovaries. And it was really being done for behavioral reasons, because women were unruly, because they were masturbating, because they had minds of their own. All of these were seen as reasons by the family to take them to a doctor and for the doctor to then remove the ovaries. What we have done in the course of that 100 years is shift the location. We've included breasts for a mastectomy and similarly now with hysterectomy. So it's a kind of prejudice of the medical profession that if you're not going to use your uterus, perhaps it should come out.
Sexually provocative.
Yeah, they're the ones that you know.
They're the ones doing it.
Yeah, yeah. You can tell by the way they walk and their just whole attitude. Then you can tell that the ones that don't. It's just their whole attitude.
The way they bring themselves across and
stress. They're just, you know, everything. The way they walk, the way they talk, the way they act.
Oftentimes, people act friendly or talk warmly to be accepted or to make friends. It has nothing to do with wanting to be raped or deserving to be raped. The youngest victim in Hawaii has been 2 months old. The oldest victim was 98 years old.
You know, it's not, there's a borderline between where they're being nice to you because they want to be with you and where they're asking for something that they really aren't ready to get into. Like if there's someone comes up to you and asks you to dance or something like that, there's a fine line between asking you to dance and asking you to go to bed.
A kind of girl who uses what faculties she has, to manipulate
things.
People.
To get things, so,
to
get
manipulate
a ride.
Manipulate people. Or, and often with no results. And girls set themselves up that way. I'm not, again, this is just some girls, and I'm not saying this is justification for any kind of sexual or other abuse. I'm just saying that some girls are like this. And girls who act like that incite people to smash them, just in general. I mean, to use a very famous phrase, but I know it's an asinine one, but it's a famous phrase, and sometimes it's applicable. Some people ask for it.
Some people ask for it. What are we telling ourselves here? Do certain clothes and actions make rape okay? The victim's fault? Well, look at what society tells us. You know, that dressing a certain way and acting a certain way is hip. you know, and get us popular. But on the other hand, if we do dress and act that way, we're asking for it. We deserve to be violently abused by another person in our community. Where do these confusing ideas come from?
Everywhere. Television, magazines.
Everyone, other people. Yeah,
peer pressure has a lot to do with it. What other people are wearing.
What's for sale here? The product or the person?
He raped me, he beat me, and he put me in the hospital.
Rape? Hospital? It cannot be. Raoul is a gentleman. You were with Raoul, see? The question to me is, how much you say no? But you really mean yes.
These confusing messages give us the myths that numb us to violence and make abuse acceptable.
We of the Yolo County Sexual Assault and Battered Women's Center's Rape Prevention Project are a small group of women and men who have attempted a difficult task, designing and implementing a rape prevention project to educate men about rape. Our primary goal has been to change what has been solely seen as a woman's problem to an issue men need to share responsibility for, rape prevention. It is estimated by the FBI that nationwide, 1 in 3 women will be sexually assaulted in her lifetime, and 1 in 4 girls will be assaulted before she reaches the age of 18. Most sexual assault prevention programs have been victim or situation oriented. Women, for example, have been told not to go out alone at night, advised on how to dress or walk, or encouraged to take self-defense and assertiveness training classes. Similarly, children have been warned to beware of strangers and in some cases, taught how to recognize and deal with dangerous situations. Such prevention efforts are valuable and need to be continued. The assumption that underlies them, however, can be misleading, namely, that if women and children would only change their behavior, men would stop assaulting them. We believe that until men begin talking to other men to change our behaviors and attitudes about sexual assault, men's violence against women and children will not stop.
92% of all of the violence is being done by men. Mm-hmm. Why focus on teaching women not to go out late at night?
I'm not trying to pin it on women. I'm saying it's larger than men or women. I think it's our problem.
I agree it's society's problem. It, just to my head, 92% of the men are doing the violent crimes. Why look anywhere else to make any changes?
Well, I agree those are the men's behaviors we have to change, but I don't think it's only man's responsibility to institute the instruments that may change that behavior.
I'm hearing a lot of defensiveness that I don't see justification for in the questions. Okay, question 20 says sexual assault is a man's problem. Okay, that's true. It doesn't say anything about it's only a man's problem. It doesn't say that, you know, anything about sharing responsibility. It just says sexual assault is a man's problem. And I think we as men have a problem if we can't sit here and say yes, that's true, okay? Then it says sexual violence against women and children will not stop until men take responsibility for it and change their behavior. It doesn't say that nobody else should do it. It says men should do this. Mm-hmm. And it won't stop until men do it. And if we can't sit here and say, yes, that's true, you know, no, nothing in schools, nothing wherever. If I can't do it right here, sitting in this seat, say, you know, that I'm willing to do something about it myself, that I feel some shared responsibility for that myself, I think, you know, we're starting to look and see where our problems are.
You know, some of the stuff that's going on. When's the last time you sat down and talked with any friends of yours about rape prevention, about something you could do to make less violence? You know, that basically our research finds that men talk about sports scores, how drunk they got, how many women they screwed, and some work stuff.
Can men and women work effectively together on this issue of sexual assault? Could women alone effectively work to educate men about sexual assault? Could men work on this issue alone?
I think men can, especially men who don't want to deal with these things and who are very threatened by these issues, can dismiss it if it's a woman talking. But if I go out there and I really challenge them, they'll respond to that. Because that's the way men interact. One challenges the other and they have to defend themselves. We get in an argument and pretty soon we're talking about all the right things. And they're getting a new perspective.
I would have been like the people in the some of the people in this center last September who would not have wanted men to get involved in coming to the center because of the difference in the atmosphere and it's good and it's empowering to see only women working together on an issue like this or working on and making progress. There's value in that, and there's also value in men and women working together. And I've really come to the conclusion, and 2 months ago I would have been really surprised to hear myself say this, but I think that the only way we can ultimately end this is to find men and women working together on the issue and on the problem. You know? Emma, I'm sorry.
When abortion was illegal, women resorted to back alley abortions, often under the most dangerous and degrading circumstances. Why shouldn't all women have access to safe, legal abortions? Why must any woman consider walking down back alleys? Restore Medicaid-funded abortion. For more information, call California Abortion Rights Action League, 751-0300.
It just seems to me that since the first thing any revolutionaries take over, whether from one political scope or the other, is communications, that obviously communications are important. And television is the most racist, sexist, exclusivistic kind of communication. So my theory is always I should be where most people are afraid to go.
We talked to striking clerks at the downtown Kaufman's. Their strike lasted for 10 weeks and ended on May 17th of 1985.
What's the major thing you're after in the strike?
Well, the reason we went on strike in the first place basically was to ensure our Sunday pay. We had premium pay, time and a half for Sundays. They came up with this new plan where they would make Sunday a regular straight pay, but they would give you a bonus, which they would in fact hold for 3 months. And then give it to you with no interest.
Yeah.
of course, that's just one way to work Sunday into another day of the week.
Right, and most of the people are women, so I guess you all have family responsibilities.
Yes, we do.
So Sunday is an important day.
Certainly it is. For a lot of people today, when two family members work,
right,
the only day of the week that you really have for family is Sunday. If it becomes another day of the week, the next option will be there will be no option.
Yeah.
Actually, it'll be a mandatory. It won't be voluntary. And I really think that's what it's working toward.
Mandatory.
And I think if people, if the public understood that this is not just an issue for Kaufman's people, this is an issue that could encircle everybody eventually.
Right. Hi, are you shopping at Kaufman's today?
Yes, I am.
Don't you support the strike?
I don't know anything about it, so I don't want to get involved.
What would help to support this strike? Does anybody have any ideas what could help to keep you going?
Mostly the public. We need the Pittsburgh people to help us. And I think
we need them to care.
Yeah,
we
need them. When they see the on strike sign, it must be something that we are asking for. So don't pass us up.
That was the first midnight I ever worked in my life. I went in and I didn't know whether to look up, down, or which way. Because when I looked up, I saw a crane, but I was scared I'd fall into a hole. So I had to look down to make sure I didn't trip. And then I heard trains coming and I didn't know what was going on, and it was all new to me. But anyhow, being in the trades, I learned how to use tools. I learned how to do wiring. I learned how to break down motors, put motors back together again, which all I felt was very interesting.
Okay.
Anytime you go from $90 a week to $350 a week, that helps make changes in your life. Having medical coverage made all the difference in the world. Now I didn't have to wait until the kids were almost about to pass out before I took them to the doctor. You know, you consider those things when you don't have medical coverage. You know, and took them all to the dentist immediately. You know, I just lined the appointments up. My little 8-year-old Tina needed protective crowns on 4 of her teeth, which ran close to $600, which her permanent teeth would have came in rotten if we hadn't got those crowns put on them.
The demolition of blast furnaces in the early 80s marked the decline of American steel. The workers, unions, and communities involved fell victim to sweeping cuts made in distant corporate boardrooms.
The loss of jobs, taxes, and services devastated many steel towns. Some of the unemployed uprooted their families to seek work elsewhere. Those who stayed found it was hard to find a job, any job. Hidden within this community in crisis lies our story. The women of steel face special problems, ones unique to women. Studies on industrial layoffs have shown that it's harder for women to find reemployment than the men they worked with. Women who were steelworkers found their options limited, once again, to traditional women's jobs.
Right now, I'm employed as a waitress at Pizza Hut on Route 51. But Pizza Hut, what they call waitress, is more involved than I've ever had. I mean, we do major cleaning, and we wash dishes and wash windows and things of that sort. In this particular case, they can require me to do one thing one day and change it the following day. If they decide to play games with you, you're stuck between a rock and a hard place. The only way you benefit is if someone in management likes you. Now, with a union, you have recourse. You have a way to fight if they're being unfair or unrealistic or something of that sort. Non-union, you're stuck.
When I first started at the mill, I was making approximately $5 an hour. Now, through the apprenticeship, for a total period of 6 years, I eventually worked my way up to top rate to where I was making $12 an hour when I was laid off. Of course, the job I now have pays $2 an hour.
I feel like I'm sort of going around in a circle because I left social work intentionally going into the mill to make more money, and I came back around through being a receptionist, which I was in the 60s, And right now I'm employed with the Mon Valley Unemployed Committee. We're in the mill. I was making approximately $10.50 an hour. Here at Mon Valley, I'll be making $6 an hour, and I don't have any medical coverage.
Throughout their 9-year marriage, Cheryl and her second husband, Jim, have weathered many financial crises. Even combining Cheryl's income with Jim's modest salary as a counselor, 2 years ago, the Johnsons found they could not pay the rising gas bills to heat their home.
We could either eat or we could pay utility bills along with the other bills. And that's when we figured out we could eliminate the heating.
We burn wood and coal, you know, and that's to save on utilities. So we've tried to cut the corners as much as possible, and we come up with a pretty trim picture, you know.
In 1968, Mrs. Bolden and others were the leaders of a movement to bring new respectability to occupations long denied. She founded the National Domestic Workers Union of America to provide training and placement, but also to bring new professionalism and pride to the working ranks.
We moved from $1.50 a week to $3 per week, and we moved from $3 a week to $3 a day. And I was fitting into all those categories, and anger built up. We didn't have any sick benefits. We didn't have any insurance. And I got sick of that. I'm not a damn scrub woman. I'm giving you my love. I'm giving you my care. I'm giving you my understanding. So this is the most important field of labor, because it's dealing directly with a family. You're giving them something that is most precious to them, is love, the most respect. You couldn't give a maid any job that says that I got to do so-and-so. She know her job. The lady don't have to do one thing to tell her nothing. She goes in there. She's a counselor. She's a mama. She's everything. If I was to name off what she really is, you just said, well, Miss Bolden, you're right. When a maid been with her family so long, when a voice is fitting to come up, do you know who holds that family together? That maid. She been a genius in after us. She's a juror, because she does all that. Who tells the children about birds and bees? Nobody but the maid. When you want to leave somebody here in your house with your children, who are you going to leave? I'm going to leave the maid. I can trust her.
By 1973, the forces that Mrs. Bolden helped set into motion culminated in lucrative opportunities for many. In that year, in Marietta, Georgia, changes were taking place to alter the shape and complexion of the industry. Leone Ackerley, with the help of her husband Bill, began a systems approach to cleaning called Mini Maids.
Mini Maid is more of a service that you would purchase much the way you might go to a fast food shop and buy a hamburger. We come very specific, specially trained and equipped, and do this specific job. So we're not really viewed by the consumer or by ourselves as being a domestic service. Mini Maid is a light housekeeping service, and they render that specific limited chore.
Leone Ackerley describes Mini Maids.
How does that work?
Well, of course, we are the pioneers of the team cleaning. And in a team, there are four ladies, four mini maids. And each mini maid is trained to do a specific chore in a specific way. And there is a lot of time that is spent with that individual teaching her her job and how to perform it within the team. And it's very much like Bill said, a military squad. Everything is very precise, and everyone is very sharp and knows their job very well. Almost like poetry in motion.
What about your younger sister or some children that maybe, you know, your children when they grow up? Suppose they told you, Mommy, I think I want to do what you do. What would you say?
I don't really think I'd like that. I guess I'm like most mothers. I want them to be rich and famous and have somebody cleaning their house instead of somebody instead of them cleaning somebody else's house.
I listen at the mini maid. I listen to every kind of maid. Everybody calls me. I want to set up this kind of business. I want to set up this type of business. Can I come out and talk to you? I got stuff wrote down that maids can do so-and-so, so-and-so. I got other things I done did training on. I done taught all around this country looking at it and talked about the same identical thing. I know what this is all about. This is money-making for the benefit of the person that's in business. How much is the maid making? That's the first thing you want to know. How much is she clearing? Look how many houses she got to clean before she can clear any damn thing. So she can get in one house and clear the same amount. So I'm listening at them. This is another thing to exploit what? Black women's and the poor white. The first thing, she ought to be making a decent salary because she don't have the friend's benefits. She don't have health and insurance, but that white woman got it in that office where she's sitting down taking them jobs, ain't she? She got it, ain't she? But the maid don't have it. And that's what I'm working on to get it.
This is a layout drawing of the laundry that I grew up when I was younger with my two parents, younger sister, and baby brother. So in the mornings when I was 5, I would get up from the sofa, which we opened up at night, and this was the largest area in the laundry. How far it folded out was about 6 feet, and it was about 6 feet wide. So after waking up, I would run to turn on the TV over here and watch cartoons. And after watching half an hour of cartoons, I would have to make breakfast. So I would squeeze by another folded out bed past my sister's and go into the kitchen here. And at the stove, I would make, you know, eggs and coffee. And after I finished cooking, I would run back out and wake up my sisters and then my parents. And then my brother would be sleeping in this crib at the foot of the sofa, and everyone would wake up and we'd run around and we'd fold up the sofa, fold up this folding table, and we'd come over here where we put a folding table, like a card table, and 6 folding chairs, and we would put it right in this area, open it up, and have our eggs and milk and juice and stuff. And I would have to rush out through this curtain that separated the living quarters from where my father worked, and I would just run out and just push through this little wooden door that was about that high and run out the door to school. And then at 3 o'clock, I would run back in through this little swinging door, and then my father would be here. He'd be ironing at the ironing board, and he'd say hello, you know, and the customers would go through the same door and they would look over the counter and give their tickets to my father. But I would run back here, and my mother would be, you know, cooking or doing the housework, taking care of my two sisters and my baby brother. And I guess one of my favorite spots was right here by this curtain. And sometimes I would just sit here and watch my mother cooking in the kitchen or holding my baby brother and feeding him after school. And kind of peeking through at my father, ironing the shirts and talking to the customers.
August, Chapter 7, The Agronomy of Desire.
Or The Hatching of the Rough Beast.
Nice orange, a few pits.
Once when I was very small,
inside,
my family was driving south through mile after mile of orange orchards in Florida. We were very poor then, and at one point my dad suddenly pulled our old Mercury to the side of the road, and we all piled out and grabbed all the ripe oranges we could from under the trees, maybe a bushel of oranges altogether. Those oranges, sweet, juicy, fragrant, were all we ate for 2 days, spitting the seeds out the car window as we continued south.
No, it's... Those oranges, sweet, juicy, fragrant, were all they ate for 2 days, spitting the seeds out the car windows as they continued south.
Scoop out the seeds. All the insides have to come out.
It's occurred to me that I resemble a piece of fruit ripening toward the future. The seed within feeds on me almost like a parasite. The soft interior tissues of my body, like the pulp of an orange, make up its entire world, its entire economy. But in order to bring the seed safely into the larger world, we need insurance, which we don't have, or money, of which we have too little, or Medi-Cal, for which we must apply to the state. In a simpler world, perhaps we'd be able to go to the medicine man, or more probably the midwife, bearing a large basket of fruit and vegetables.
Nicely. Cool. Emptied of all its filling, all the pits out.
The first question at the Medi-Cal office is, who is the father? The second question is, who is the father? It's also the third and fourth questions. Did you think that you could apply on your own for your own medical care?
Right through the middle.
The Medi-Cal worker leans over the desk towards me, his jaws tightening, his contempt slobbering onto his chin as he continues. This state is interested in what it defines as a family unit. The more he sees me from the outside in, the more my body turns inside out. His clipboard is upside down, so I can't see what he's written. He hands me some papers. Return with these forms completely filled out, he says. As I stand, my legs wobble. I'm too dizzy to protest. Outside the office, I double over in pain, retching on the sidewalk. The vomit is green in the California sunlight, like the color of money. If it was possible to vomit U.S. currency, I'd now be leaning over the heads of Lincoln, Jackson, Washington, Hamilton, Franklin. This vomit also has bits of cracker in it, but no fruit.
Hold tight.
Hold tight.
Hold tight. Hold tight.
Hold tight.
Crack back of water, people.
I want seafood, mama.
I want seafood, mama.
I want seafood, mama.
Por ina naku, por ina naku ga, por ina ya, por ito a, yo dene, dene goya, dene goya, por ini, so que ella son bai que ya, por ini, so que ella son bai que ya,
Thousand women from 160 countries gathered in Nairobi, Kenya to attend the non-governmental organization Forum 85. Held from July 10th to July 19th, women met to mark the culmination of the United Nations Decade for Women. A separate conference from the official UN conference, it was open to all women. The non-governmental organization Forum consisted of a wide variety of workshops, panels, and cultural events organized and conducted by women's groups from all over the world. Development, peace, and equality were the official themes of the conference. Within these three themes emerged hundreds of issues which were discussed, reviewed, and debated over the forum week. Held at the University of Nairobi, the campus was transformed into an international meeting ground for women. Different issues held priority for women in different countries. While women in Western countries talked about equal pay and nuclear disarmament, most women talked about basics, such as health, clean water, food, and the survival of their families. Although conflict arose, there was also agreement and a solidarity of spirit, hope, and continued struggle among the women who attended Forum 85. Many gains have been made for women throughout the world during the UN Decade for Women. For example, the number of countries with equal pay laws has increased from 28 to 90 since 1978. The fact remains, however, that women still perform 2/3 of the world's work, receive 1/10 of its income, and own less than 1/100 of its property. It was thus evident that struggles for women's equality must continue and is tied to a global economic order. Whether the struggle involved placing women in decision-making positions, national liberation movements, eliminating the mail order bride trade in Asia, or curtailing nuclear proliferation among the superpowers, these are all women's issues. And the women, whether from Kenya, Singapore, or the U.S., are bringing these messages back home.
The day you try. so don't you stop and scratch. Cause you're counting chickens that were never had. I ain't your hen, Mr. Fly Rooster, so don't crow in my backyard. I ain't your hen, Mr. Fly Rooster, so don't crow in my backyard. Here's one chicken you ain't picking. The day you try, you find it hard. You and I ain't never gonna come to terms. Find some other chicken, I don't need your worms. I ain't your hen, Mr. Fly Rooster, so don't crow in my backyard.
We did.